Sure. Thank you.
Well, welcome. I just want to point something out, just like your students, no one's sitting in the front row. Right? Okay. Of course. I want to thank you for coming. I know it's a crazy time of year, right? You've got finals coming up, right? You have lots of papers to grade, you have lots of things to do. So hopefully from this workshop, you'll be a bit energized, not only going into the end of the semester, but starting if you're teaching summer school or in the fall semester when we move on. So why don't we get started? These are my feelings, and I think Mike, you captured it well. We always say that doctors save lives, right? But I believe you, as educators, save lives. In fact, an educator like yourself saved mine. And this is how important and the strength that I believe in what you do with students, how important that is to their lives. Because you're teaching people how to learn. You're teaching people that, in fact, they can move on to earn a living wage and support their family. And my guess is you have some student stories where this is very, very true. You're teaching them how to view the world and engage with the community. And so my belief is that the core of any educational institution is all of you. And my job, and Mike will tell you this, when I directed academic services, research, and planning for Coast Quan Cui Maca Community College District, I always felt like everyone was my boss. And so that whatever faculty needed in order to do their job better to support students, that was my job. That's what I care deeply about. And I'd like you just to think about for a second, as a faculty member, the moment or the moments where you feel the best in your job. Is it grading papers? Probably not. Is it developing new assignments? Probably not. But let me ask you, when that student comes back to you, after leaving you, and they've gone 2 or 3 years, and they come to you and they say, what's your name?
Tracy.
Tracy, I need to tell you, you got me excited about learning. You're the reason I went over to the university and got my degree, because of what you did in that classroom. You've all had that experience, have you not? And quite frankly, when I taught, that was my favorite experience. It wasn't the material, although I love teaching statistics, I'm a geek. But look who I'm talking to, right? You're all geeks, you're all math geeks, right? So it was really that experience that was so powerful for me. And what we want to do is we want to make those moments more plentiful. And have any of you heard of the Chip and Dan Heath folks that write these books, Switch, other kinds of things? Well, they have a book called Moments, The Power of Moments, brand new. And it talks about how to create those moments. And what they talk about is basically a moment could have up to 4 characteristics. The first one is that you feel elevated. How many of you have had this experience where students come back to you or sent you a letter or whatever, right, about how you help them? The second one is that you feel pride, right? I'm proud that I did this, right, that I helped these students be successful. The third is that you gain some insight. And that insight may be, okay, what you were doing actually led to the student being successful. And then finally, the other one is making a connection, right? As human beings, we're social animals. And it's important that we're not just didactically delivering material, but that we're making a connection with our students, especially in math courses. How many of your students come in and are terrified of mathematics? Terrified. By the way, here's what the national data say. For institutions that don't require students to take math up front, when do you think they take mathematics? At the very end. And in fact, it keeps them from graduating. It keeps them from moving forward to meeting their goals. They're terrified. They've had bad experiences. And now it's time to change that. So let's do a little exercise. And I'd like you to turn to your colleague, maybe just 2 at a time or 3 at a table, whatever you like. And I'd like you to just answer this question. Thinking back about what led you to a career in education, who or what inspired you? Who or what inspired you? So let's take a few minutes just sharing with one another. By the way, we're going to report out. And the rule about reporting out is you can't say, he said. Oh, okay, you have to say what you said.
Okay, fair enough.
All right, so let's do that for 2 minutes.
Instructors make all these, you know, whatever they need instructors, right? On the math department, I was like, washing transparency is like, I'm not washing really good transparencies, but I see you in the future that you're going to be an educator. And I'm like, I don't even see myself like that. But that makes you realize. Also, exactly. Also, when you were a tutor on that time, the students come back to you and they say, you have the passion, but you don't accept it. I went back to the company. I worked for 2 years after I graduated from my master's degree. I came back because, yes, I have a passion.
Wonderful. A passion. Wonderful stories. Wonderful stories. Do we all have stories like this? We all have stories like this. And so the reality is, in your classroom, you are inspiring students every day. You are inspiring them, even around math, right? Which tends to be taken away and all that good stuff. So thank you very much for sharing. Now, I understand Mike and I have had a conversation before this workshop, and I understand that your math placement criteria is changing, right? Below 8705, right? Math sequencing is changing, right? You have developed, you're developing a co-requisite model, right? And that's coming online. And you're working on flipped classrooms, right? A completely different way to engage students in material. So what you're doing here is a structural change, and you're doing essentially a pedagogical change. Where's the human change? So we're still interacting with students in the same way. So what I want to talk to you about today is how we can interact with students in a different way with intentionality, in a different way in which students are going to work their, this is being taped, work their tails off to be successful. And I'm also going to tell you, and we'll talk more about this later, is that for institutions that have engaged in this work, and by the way, there's no cost to it, it's all free. For institutions that engage in work, faculty satisfaction goes way up. It goes way up. And so why don't I walk you through this and you tell me what you think. Okay. Basically, this human part is all about faculty to student engagement. It's about how you as instructors engage with your students to create those moments for your students' lives, to change how they feel about mathematics, to change how they feel about learning, and ultimately enable them to earn a living wage, take care of their families, and go on to do great things. We call this doing good and doing well. And the reason we do that is, I don't know if you've seen the statistics, I'm going to show you this in a minute, but community college population, as well as higher in general, is going down. I don't know what your enrollment is. Mike, you up or down in enrollment?
We are flat.
Flat, okay. But it's not growing, right? So, you know.
We actually grew for a couple of years, but other colleges are flat going
down. That's right.
But we're now kind of seeing it as well.
Yeah, so across the nation, it's actually going down. And when it goes down, that's a problem because that means revenue. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. But funding is mostly based on enrollment. And in fact, here's a table that I pulled from the National Student Clearinghouse, which collects data from 90-something percent of all colleges and universities. And I know this is a little hard to see, but basically what we're looking at is fall 2015, fall 2016, fall 2017. And I'd like to bring your attention to the two-year public college, although everyone's down. But take a look here where that arrow's showing up. In fall 2015, across the nation, enrollment dropped by almost 3%. I know, your math instructors, it dropped by 2.9%. Okay. In fall 2016, it was 2.6%, the drop. And then finally, this last year in 2017, we're down to 1.7%. And there's a book out that just came out from John Hopkins Press by a guy named Nathan Dowd. And he talks about, and the title of the book is, The Demand, Demographics and the Demand for Higher Education. And you guys would love this book because it's very statistically oriented, but he breaks the United States up into 63 regions. And he looks at the college-going population and a whole bunch of other factors, and it doesn't look good. In fact, it doesn't look good for the next few years. So things are dropping. And I know the formula is changing with the California Community Colleges. It's going to about 50 or 60%, depending on what they decide upon for the FTE. but that's still going to affect colleges. Now, the drop, the decrease is flattening out a little bit, but it's going down. In fact, if you read this book, what it tells you is that community colleges are likely to expect double-digit reductions. So in the teens, the low teens is what he's saying. And that's a little terrifying, because if we think about how we're funded by enrollment, for the most part, when monies go down, that means we have less services, we can't hire faculty when they leave, we can't hire administrators when they leave, that kind of thing. So what happens is we tend to cut. And I know Mike and I lived through an experience way back when at Grossmont Cuyamaca, where it wasn't just cutting flesh, it was cutting bone, right? Because the demographics were just awful. But if you're interested, this book is Demographics and the Demand for Higher Education, Nathan Dowd. It's an excellent book. But this data from the Clearinghouse kind of shows that problem. Look at for profits. That's they just killed.
And you would think,
in some ways I think so. But there are some for profits that aren't bad. We can't just necessarily wave all of them with a broad brush. But I would argue you're right. There are a lot of them that were not good.
No, what I'm saying is that in this new administration, those are going to increase.
You're absolutely right.
The way the regulations.
So Lamar Alexander, who's been so wonderful about this, in the Congress, and really called these institutions to account, that's now all going to change. You're absolutely right. Okay, any questions about this? All right, so we have a situation here where things are going on. So then we think about it, so what do we do? Well, one of the ways to address this is not just doing good and helping students do better, but when they do better, the data tells us that they stay. In other words, students that earn an A, B, C, or credit, what we call success grade, they persist from semester to semester. In fact, 80% of those students on average persist from fall to spring. If they don't earn a positive grade, can you guess what the number is, what percent persists? Exactly right. Who said 20? Thank you. Very good. 20%. 20%. So the work on engagement also helps students be successful, which also helps increase the bottom line. And I'm going to show you data of colleges that have worked on these kinds of techniques where they're one of the only colleges in the entire region that's going up in enrollment. In fact, significantly in enrollment. Why? Because they're keeping the students they have, not trying to continue to find students that they don't have. Okay. Student population is decreasing. We talked about you can do good by helping students be more successful. And the reality is I'm going to show you a lot of data on how engagement works. And by the way, some people will say, well, this is, it's not a new concept, engagement. In fact, it's not a new concept. You ever hear of Vince Tinto? Vince Tinto is kind of the guru on engagement. He talked about a model, and he has several books on self-efficacy, how students feel about themselves, sense of belonging to an institution. How many students have you encountered that have come to your office and says, I really can't do this, I shouldn't be in college? Right? Tinto focuses on that. The perceived value of the curriculum, meaning how does math help me for what I want to do in life? And then Dick Light, he's actually a statistician, you may have heard of him. He's a professor at Harvard, he came out with a book, and he talks about the kinds of things students need to do in order to stay in school and be successful. And the key item is they need to connect with a faculty member. They need to connect with a faculty member. How many of you have students that come back to your office, even when they're not in your class, just to say hello? Right? Just to say hello. Thank you. So that's what we want to talk about engagement. And I'm going to walk you through a college, Odessa College. Now, have you heard of Achieving the Dream? Achieving the Dream is a national initiative. It focuses on coaches coming to help colleges around the country. There's about 230 colleges, and I'm one of the original coaches way back when, 15 years ago. And Odessa College, when I first came to them, about 2008, was actually on the closure list. It was going to be defunded. Texas was, remember what happened in 2008, right? The housing crisis? Right? It was really in bad shape. And when revenue mostly comes, property taxes, to fund us, there were three colleges that there was a legislature that proposed to defund. Odessa was one of them. I'm so happy I'm a new coach. I'm coming on in, and they're telling me they're going to be defunded. That was a great joy in my life. So, they also have lots of other issues. The previous leadership had screwed up the budget so badly they were in deficit spending. Could you imagine that? Okay, now we've got to hire people. How do we hire people? We can't do that. They had a lot, their buildings were in disrepair. It was a mess. And 3 years after us coaching, because that's how long it takes me to get anything done, 3 years, they found religion. And they started actually what I'm going to talk to you about. They're really the originators. So Odessa was trying to figure out, how do we improve student success? How do we get students all the way to graduation? And the president was just brilliant. His name was Greg Williams. And Greg Williams would say, look, I don't have enough resources to focus on everything, right? Because a lot of colleges, they like, let's do a whole bunch of stuff. And then they say, oh, look at all the stuff we're doing. And then the needle on student success doesn't move. Greg was really smart. What Greg said is, look, I can't focus on graduation. I just don't have the resources. But what I do know is that almost every student who comes to Odessa College, they want to pass a class. So if they want to pass a class, I know I got to keep them in class. That's called student retention, right? All but W. Think about it that way. All but W. And what he found is that when they looked at data across all their courses, they found that there were some faculty that had drop rates of only 4%. That means 96% of all of their students stayed in class throughout the whole semester. Some faculty, on the other hand, had drop rates of 30%. Right? That means 70% of them stayed, right? So they said, we gotta do something about drop rates. So they went deep, deep, deep into the data. And they were trying to figure out, what are the causes of all this stuff? Why are students dropping? What's going on? Now, we all know that females do better than males. Right? That's what the data shows. Females do better than males. But yet, there are males that are doing better than the average of females. So, okay, it's not a male-female thing. Full-time, part-time. The data does show that if you're a full-time student, you do better than a part-time student. But yet, there were part-time students that were earning 4.0s. Okay, not that. Okay, maybe they're first-time students in college. They just don't know how to do college. They don't know how it works. So let's check on that. Well, they looked at first-time in college students, and a lot of those first-timers were doing just fine. It wasn't that they were random. What about online courses? The national data shows that in the same course taught by the same instructor, the success rates are about 10 to 18% lower online. Do you have that experience here at Citrus? Right? That's what the national data show. Well, guess what? Some students in online courses, some online courses, rock stars, doing really, really well. Okay, academic standing, right? We have academic standing issues here in California, right? Whether they're on lack of progress probation, which is the W, lots of W's, or they're on academic probation, even students who were on probation ended up doing just fine. Okay, ethnicity. We all know there are differences in ethnicity in terms of success rates. But those in traditionally underrepresented groups who don't tend to do well, many of them were doing just as well as everybody else. What about age? Okay, the older you are, the better you do. Thank goodness for me. But, and young students don't do as well. But the reality is there were some young students who were just fine. They were doing great. Okay, oh, time thing. That 8 o'clock class. Students roll in. They haven't had their Suki drug or coffee. Right? They're not awake. Those 8 o'clock students just don't do well. Guess what? Lots of 8 o'clock classes did just fine. So he looked at all these different things. This was Dr. Don Wood, who was doing an interesting story I'll tell you about later. But they looked at all these student factors. They could not find anything that would relate directly to why students were not staying in class, that 30% of dropping. So then what they did was they did something really smart. They started talking to instructors. And they talked to instructors who had really low drop rates. And they basically said, what are you doing? And by the way, they didn't tell them why they were talking to them. They simply said, I want to observe your class. I want to talk to you. I want to learn about your teaching styles. I want to learn about what you're doing. They just talked to them. And what was really fascinating about this, it wasn't pedagogy. It wasn't online or face-to-face. They couldn't find anything. So they would have some instructors doing traditional didactic, others doing flipped classrooms, you know, students working in groups, whatever it was, they couldn't find the difference. So they interviewed all these instructors, and they couldn't see what was going on that was different. But here's one thing they did find. So again, teaching methods didn't matter. Didn't matter. But here's what did matter. Human relationships. What they found was that instructors engaged in specific sets of behaviors that caused students to not drop, and in fact, stay in class. I mean, really fascinating stuff, right? I mean, this is, you know, we read about it with Tinto and Light and so forth, but they were actually qualifying those specific behaviors. What were they? Four things. It's actually more than that, we'll talk about it, but this is what they call their four commitments. First, interact with students by name. Interact with students by name. Let me ask you a question. How many of you raise your hand if you have a favorite restaurant? Nobody goes out to eat? Come on. Look at me. I have favorite restaurants. Okay. Favorite restaurant. Okay. What do you like about that restaurant? What makes it a favorite restaurant? Okay. Beyond the food, what makes it a favorite restaurant?
Service.
Service. Tell me more about the service.
Personal.
It's personal. Oh, what a concept. And sometimes you have a favorite restaurant, the food's good, but the other place down the street is better. But because how I am treated at that restaurant, it makes me feel good, does it not?
Yes.
So think about that. Think about that. You're going to a restaurant, the food's okay, it's good, but it's that they know my name. They know what I order. I sit down and they bring me the drink I like. Right? See the difference here? So they're interacting with students by name. They're also closely monitoring student progress. So one of the things that they do is when a student doesn't show up, when a student doesn't do well on an assignment, and those assignments, by the way, are early and often, it is not a midterm and final. I mean, I have to tell you, we do lots of focus groups with students. Many, when we ask their questions, we say, so how are you doing in your classes? Many of them say, we don't know yet. We haven't taken the midterm. We haven't taken that seminal exam. That shouldn't be okay, right? Students should know how they're doing at all times, because when they don't know how they're doing, they disengage. But they closely monitor students' progress. The other thing they do is they get to know the student outside class. And it's not you have to come to the office hour for 15 minutes, although I want to show you Oakton State in Chicago. They do that, but it's a long story. They will, during time students are working groups, they'll pull people out and say, hey, I just wanted to know you, I'm this, tell me about yourself, that's it. They also have other ways they do that. Students write an initial paper in the very beginning of class to say what their background is. The instructor does it as well. And then the other term that they use, which I don't like, and in fact, funny story, oh, this is being taped. I will tell you I was at a university doing a workshop on cultural competence. And the faculty there got really upset with me on this one. But what is Masters of Paradigms? We like to think of it as considerate coaching, if you will. So let's say you have a student, they're doing really well, and all of a sudden they're gone. Let's say you teach every day, they're gone for 3 days. The Latino student, they're gone. What happened? Well, in Latino culture, if uncle dies, you're gone for 3 days. No matter what, you've got to go. Right? Now sometimes we'll say, oh, dropping you, right? You're gone, right? Am I right? Gone, you're gone. So there are many cultures or many issues, whether it's work-related, culture-related. So what do? Well, sometimes we just give them zero. They didn't show up, that's too bad. They're responsible, they have to work, just like every other student. But sometimes, at Odessa, they'll talk to students and what happened. They say, oh, well, uncle died, or my work shift changed, they told me at the last minute I couldn't show up. Sorry I didn't call. At that point, the instructor decides to be a considerate coach. I may, in fact, give them a zero. But I may say, just come to my office, take a test. Or turn the paper in late, I'll just give you 10% off. Hear what I'm saying here? Is that because they've gotten to know the students, it is not an all or nothing kind of thing. Now, that does not mean, and we're going to talk about this, because I brought a book on this, it does not mean you don't have rigorous policies. It does not mean that you don't have high expectations. All of those things have to be in place. But it also means sometimes people just need a break. Sometimes people just need a break. And this is what happened when I was at this university. Faculty were pushing back. And feel free to push back. But then I asked them, how many of you have ever been late for a faculty meeting? They looked at me. Then I said, how many of you have ever turned your grades in late? They stopped talking. My point is, we're imperfect creatures. Right? And if we're going to help our students be successful, consider coaching, or what they call master's paradox, is something that I would at least like you to think about. And I must tell you, I work with a number of institutions on this work. And there's a gal at one of the California institutions that just struggles with this one. And she says, well, I had to do it, my students had to do it. And I'm not teaching them to be a good student. I mean, because today I go out to the work world, and what is it they miss? Well, what are we teaching? Right? What are we teaching? So what I said to her, happens to have the same name as my wife, so there's this transference from one of them. I didn't tell you guys I'm a psychologist. Okay, sorry. But I said to her, just try it for one semester. And she's like, okay, fine, because we built a relationship. So we'll see what happens with my friend. Okay, four commitments. What do you think? What do you think of these four commitments? I'm going to detail out the specifics, but just want to hear what you think.
Makes sense?
Okay. Now, let me tell you that many of you might be thinking now, I already do this. But here's what I'm going to challenge you on, and you feel free to push back. You may already do this, but you don't do this with everyone, and you don't do this with intentionality. Meaning, in every class, you'll have four, five, six students that you get to be very friendly with. Right? That happens in every class. But what doesn't happen in most classes is every student has this connection. And what I'm asking you to think about is how to do this with intentionality. Right? How to do this in a deep way in which you make this connection. All right, I'm going to show you some data now. I'm sorry, please. Yes?
I didn't want to disrupt where you're going. I mean, I have pushback if you want. I mean,
if you feel appropriate,
I just don't want to disrupt where you're going.
No. Feel free.
Just as I'm watching this, I mean, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I mean, these are all great. And I would love to, for example, take class 9 to have one-on-one conversation with my students. How are you? I didn't know you. And what goes through my head is, okay, what evidence is there that this is going to help this student or this class of students have success? And when I say success, I don't mean a grade in class. I mean long-term success in mathematics, because I'm getting to using class time to get another student personally.
So I can't control whether they have long-term success in mathematics. I can only focus on what I can control, which is in my class. I don't know if they're going to have long-term success in mathematics. However, I can give you some data that's not up here from Odessa College, and I'll give you an example of this. Odessa College is a Hispanic serving institution. Are you guys HSI? 60-something% of their students are Hispanic. Their lowest performing population is Latino males. And in fact, in their STEM programs, they had under 10% of the 60% in STEM. When they started working on this and moved forward, they now have more Latinos in STEM than Latinos are ever in this discipline, and they're exceeding at high rates. Now, whether or not they go on to STEM at the university or go into healthcare or whatever it is they're going to STEM for, I don't know. I don't have that data. But I hear what you're saying, but I can't control what happens to them afterwards. I can only control what happens here. The other issue is, I'm going to talk to you about Oakton. When I get to Oakton, remind me to talk to you about what happens there. Thank you. But it's a great question. Okay. After intervention, drop rates. These are the drop rates before the intervention of three random instructors, right? After one semester, drop rate went from 28.1 to 6.7. That means 71.9% of the students normally stayed, now 93.3% stay. And we can just do the math, right? You guys are mathematicians, I don't have to do this. But it's pretty extraordinary what happened after one semester. One semester. Now, more data. In terms of course retention, again, overall average in fall 2010, which is right before they started this, now up to today, they had 86.3% of students getting a valid grade, not a W. Now they have 97.2. Could you imagine that? 97.2% of your students stay. And then as we move on to, this is first-time students, because we know first-time students don't do as well. Now we have all students. It was 87.5, it's now up to 98% retention. By the way, remember how I said they're one of the few colleges going up? Last year they went up 5.7% in enrollment. You measure the revenue with 5.7% enrollment, and what that does to help you hire more faculty, buy supplies, all that stuff. Yes?
I just, and not to go backwards, but I kind of was thinking about what Brian said about you. not to say that to be intentionally, you know, hard on the students, but there's going to be somewhat of a learning curve.
It's going to be different. What you're going to point out is experience in another place, especially like a very difficult institution with lots of students involved, is going to be different. But they actually learn study skills as part of the score. They learn how to study more. So yeah, it'll be more difficult for them. You are absolutely right. But hopefully, because they have learned how to do this work and be rigorous and buckle down, they're more prepared. Because if they transfer without this kind of deep work, they're doing it right. So it may not be perfect, but at least it's a little bit, I believe, more. Okay, next slide. This is course success, A, B, C, or credit. In fall 2010, it was 61.8% for first-time students. Look at their success rates, 77.4. This is overall. I'm going to show you math in a minute because I called them and they sent me math data. All student course success rates, 69.8. By the way, the national average is about 69-70%. So they were right at the national average. Fall 2016, 80.6%. Can you imagine 8 out of 10 of your students being successful? That's pretty extraordinary because I know your data in math. I've seen your data. I actually have it up if you want to see it from the chancellor's office. Okay, here's their math data that they just sent me. In 2010, in college and transfer level math courses, they had 2,106 enrollments. Their retention rate was 82%, and their success rate was 63.1. By the way, yours is 60% for college level and transfer level 63%. You're right at almost that exact same place. In 2016, this is their latest data. Look, their enrollment obviously went up because their enrollment keeps going up because they're doing this work. Their retention went up to 94.6% in math. And look at their success rates, 82.3. That's extraordinary. Now, is it as good in developmental level? No, of course not. Right? We know developmental level students are less prepared, but it's still really good. In 2010, they had 2,241 students enrollment. Their retention was 87.1%, which isn't bad, but their success rates were 50%. Right? 50%. Latest data, just fast forwarding, 98.1% retention, 75.4% success rates. Yes, you want to raise your hand?
It's the same question. I think all that matters is their long-term success. So when we say success, is in this data, is there any information about these students' long-term success?
The best I can give you is graduation data, which I'm going to give you.
But otherwise, it becomes more of it's sort of a political issue.
Okay, let me give you long-term success. This is a college that won the Aspen Award for Rising Star 2 years ago. They're likely to win the whole award this year. 5 years post-graduation, can you guess what their community college exiters who earn degrees, what their salary is? Just a guess. It's the highest in Texas, $110,000 a year. Now, does that relate to what you're saying? Maybe. I don't know. It's not necessarily causal.
Is that an average?
That's the average. It's the average. It's $110,000.
So median would probably be a better number there.
I'm not sure what average they're using. I'm not sure what measure of central tendency they're using. Are they using a mean, a median? I'm not using a mode, obviously. But so this is what I see. But look, what I'm asking you to do is suspend a little bit of disbelief. Be critical, but suspend a little disbelief. And think about this, because I'm going to show you two other colleges, not just one college. Yes.
Is there information in which being made available to us?
This whole slideshow is being filmed. Everything's being filmed. So everyone turn around and smile at the camera, right? Okay. There we go. All right. Graduation rates. In 2009, they had 608 graduates. They had one graduation a year. They have something called the Odessa Coliseum. Do you guys know Odessa, Texas? You know Friday Night Lights? That's Odessa, Texas. Football means everything in Odessa, Texas. Right? If you go to some of these small towns, football is everything. And by the way, oil means a lot. Right? You know, when we go to some colleges, they have lakes and rivers. Don Wood, who works with us sometimes, will say we have a pool of oil sitting there. Right? In the Odessa Permian Basin, it's one of the largest oil-producing regions in the world. It's huge. But there's not much else out there. Right? It's desperate. Right? It's pretty much desperate. By 2015, they're up to 1,313 graduates. I don't have their latest data, but they went up 705, which is pretty extraordinary. They have their Full-time student graduation rate just came out, it's over 50%. Their part-time graduation rate is 30%. That's how it's figured, is NCDS's way, which is 150% of the time, meaning 3 years from when a student starts. It's some of the highest rates in Texas. Highest rates in Texas. So long-term wise, this is as long-term as I can get. I don't know, I don't have transfer data to say how they did when they moved on. I do have fiscal data to see how they did once they left after 5 years, which I think is a pretty good proxy, not bad. Okay, Oakton Community College. Oakton does have a lake. Look, it's not a whale, but they have a lake. It's a beautiful place. It's north of Chicago. I'm also their Achieving the Dream data coach, and I have a funny story to tell you about Oakton. So I was with Oakton and talking to the faculty, and all of you could probably name the faculty member that is the leader at Citrus College. They may not be the head of the academic senate, but it tends to be a very senior person that everyone knows and people talk to it and listen to about what he or she says about something. When I was sitting in a room with this person, she was a philosophy instructor, is a philosophy instructor, lovely, lovely person, but we were talking about what Odessa was doing, and she was like this with me. Right? You've seen it, right? Like this with me. And I'm explaining what's going on, and she's asking really good questions and hard questions. And what's interesting is she said, I'm going to try this, and guess what? I'm going to prove Brad wrong. Cool. I love that. Prove me wrong, that's fine. I'll live with that. So her and five of her colleagues started doing this. Said, I'm going to try to do this. I'm going to do it with fidelity, these four things that Odessa does. They made it their own, which I hope you make your own if you want to do this. They made it their own, and I asked her on the very next visit, how did it go? Because I didn't even know they were doing it. And she said, I've never been happier at my job. It totally transformed how she felt about what she was doing. And now they've got 25% of the faculty doing this. They're just starting to ramp up in a big way. So what did they do? And this is these are their slides. They set clear high academic standards. But they worked on getting rid of policies that easily doom students. So in their syllabus, and we'll talk about your syllabus, they have policies that, you know, maybe if I say this thing is a zero, I'm still going to talk to you about it. Maybe I give it a zero, maybe I don't. But they have policies that just don't kill students right up front. In fact, to speak more about that, one could argue that anatomy and physiology is one of the toughest courses on the college campus. Right? I mean, I know it's a tough math course, but A and B just naturally tends to really kill students. Because it's a weed out course, right? It's a weed out course for students going into health professions and so forth. Well, I was interviewing Tom Crawford, Dr. Crawford at Odessa. And I said, so Tom, what's your philosophy about this? And he said, I don't want to get in the way of student success. I really found that fascinating. That really impacted how he was doing everything to help them. One of the things he does, and it's really fascinating, get students kind of getting together and talking to them and working with them, is on the very first day of class, he sits up on the desk and he plays his guitar. And the students come in and they sing songs together for the first half hour. I know that sounds crazy, but he's creating a culture in that classroom. And he's creating a culture in that classroom where he's going to kick their butt, right? This is a hard course. But he's creating this culture of collaboration. Learning students' names, they did that, and having students learn one another's names. See, Odessa doesn't do that, but this I thought was really brilliant that they were doing this. So they're creating this one-on-one collaborative culture. And there's a lot of online things you can do too that we can talk about. Giving feedback on an assignment or quiz right away. Sometimes we get assignments and assessments and we take a long time to give it back to them. I mean, we're busy, we've got lots of other classes. Their rule is you gotta go back in the very next class meeting. Holding 15-minute one-to-one conferences in order to get to know the students. Now, I think that's way too much. Personally, I've had discussions with them, but I attended a pinning ceremony that the president did with the faculty participating. It wasn't all of them. There were about 40, 50 faculty in the room, and they were telling their story, and getting them not to do 15 minutes on Zoom would be really, really hard once they started doing it. So we recommend just a brief connection, 5 minutes. It doesn't have to be 15 minutes, but Oakton first. I must have said something. But Oakton just got this 15 minutes in their head, and that's what they do. It's a long time. I don't recommend it, but they love doing it. Now, what are their commitments for the rest of the semester? They equate students with resources and opportunities at the college. Right? So there's tutoring, there's clubs, there's all sorts of things. They attend at least one co-curricular event with students. In other words, it's called making a connection to the institution. We live in commuter campuses. Now, I'll tell you a funny story. This is what Odessa does to make this connection. First of all, every year Odessa gives away a car to a student. This last year, we gave away two cars. Well, they gave away a car and a truck, because after all, it's Texas. Right? Ford F-150 in white. And they gave away a Mustang, by the way. They gave away a Mustang. And what they do with that is not just student performance, but students attending events. But here's the fun part. They've gone even a little bit further than that. So let me tell you what they've done. Everybody has a cell phone, right? A smartphone. They created this app called Odessa All In, or OC All In. As you know, there are a zillion things going on at Citrus College. You have plays, you have art shows, you have poetry readings. You may have a math event, right? At the Capitol, whatever it is you do. How many people really show up to those things? Not many. So what they've done is they've actually taken part of their budget, and whenever a faculty member attends, an administrator or a staff member attends, they get points. They actually have a code, a bunch of codes based on the honor system, but it's just a database that collects the points. Some events are worth a little bit of time, some are worth a lot. They're on a different system than you guys. They're 8 plus 8 weeks. They only do 16 weeks for most of their courses. But they just instituted that a couple years ago. But what happens is, at that 8-week time, or that 16-week time, they give away gift certificates. If you hit a certain level, everyone gets $25. If you hit a higher level, you get $100. Let me ask you, how crowded do you think their events are? Poetry readings, math, decathlon, whatever. Packed. Standing room only. In fact, I had the fortunate opportunity 2 years ago to attend what's called the Steinway event. Heard of Steinway pianos? Right? It's like 90% of all concert halls have Steinway pianos. Odessa College is a all Steinway college. Can you imagine that? College is all Steinway? They worked hard, they got donations. I sat next to dinner with the president of Steinway pianos, who had just flown back in from the Netherlands. And this event was going on. And he brought the Steinway jazz pianist. They gave a concert. They were standing room only, literally. And the faculty also played. So you have the Steinway jazz pianist and the faculty. So this is the kind of culture that happens when you do this kind of work that we're talking about. It brings people together, not just in the classroom, but outside of that. OK, one co-curricular event. Contacting students who are struggling in class and offering them help. And it's not just saying there's a tutoring center. It's not just saying, you know, we have help. It's when do we meet, when can we talk, let's set up an appointment. It's going that much further. It's not leaving a message. Talking with students about completing an associate's degree or certificate. Part of the reason that Oakton instituted this program is their persistence, meaning from fall to spring and fall to fall, is not very high. It's not very high. In fact, they're going down in enrollment and they're losing students. In part, it's a very affluent area, and students have lots of choices, and so they're not necessarily staying at the community college. They also participate in assessment activities. So they had groups that did assessment of how it's working, how it's not working, so they're constantly monitoring, which I thought was really cool. And things that are listed on the field. Now, about 1/4 of the students were enrolled in at least one session with a participating faculty member. And this initiative, they call it the Faculty Persistence Initiative, right? So you can see who participated. I know in the back it's hard to see. There are about 2,388 students that participated. Non-participated was 7,024. Now, what happened? In terms of their persistence, because this is what they focused on, if you participated in this initiative from fall to spring for new students, their persistence went up to 82.7%. I would argue that's really, really high. From the national data that I'm aware of, that's really, really high. This is what it was of the students that didn't participate in those faculty members' courses. Increase of 24.1%. Now, some of you may say, well, look, faculty participated, it's selection bias, they did this because they just wanted to. And in fact, I would argue you're right. However, entire departments, including part-timers, adjunct faculty, participated. So while there is some selection bias, they have whole departments that went in. And by the way, the one big department went in, that went in, because the chair just bugged us. Okay, so this is their fall to spring persistence for new students. Now let's talk about equity, right? We've been focused on equity in California for quite some time. There's a student equity initiative. I'm going to argue it hasn't had the kind of effects that we would hope for, but this kind of work actually increases student success for traditionally underrepresented students. So let's take a look at this. Asian populations, Black, Latinx, whites, and others. What's the greatest increase in persistence rates for new students? Black students, African American students. It's not everywhere, and all the data I'm going to show you, but this I thought was really fascinating because their overall persistence in general was 45.9%. And now it's at 78.9, which you could argue is pretty much killed the achievement gap. We're pretty close to that end. Okay, you can see what happened with Latino students, white students, others, and of course the Asian students are already high. Okay, now we're looking at persistence rates from fall to fall. These are year-long persistence rates. Yes, please. Absolutely, yes.
Just a paraphrase.
And again, this is their data. But here's the part that really blew me away. For for all the courses the faculty have just stated, and I would argue it's probably selection bias. Yes?
I was just going to ask, and some of the numbers that look kind of pretty convincing, but were there hypothesis tests on the p-values, or were there confidence intervals that just give the difference of our all statistically significant?
So,
I know the one sample is only 38.
It's a small sample, exactly right. But what they're doing is they're building the data over time, and we all run a five-dimension sample size, and, as a statistician, I can tell you, we have the issue of Cohen's D, right? You guys know what Cohen's D is, it's what's called an effect size, and the issue is when, in mathematics, you know that in order to see a difference at whatever p-value, 0.05 or 0.01, if the n is higher, meaning lots of constant, and it's a small change, that p-value will go, whether it's an order of correlation, whatever. If it's a small n, you need a very wide difference in order for that to happen. So at this point, I don't think any of that hypothesis testing was done, but I will tell you, we're now in conversations with the King College Research Center to do those kinds of testing where we randomize controls. The problem with randomized controls, and you guys can agree to this, I bet, when the faculty at Oakton were asked about this work, they only asked them to do it in one class, right? In part because they did this 15-minute thing, meeting with students, that's a lot of time. But what they said was it was a Machiavellian bargain, meaning they couldn't keep doing it from their other classes because they felt that it was working. So when it comes to randomized controlled experiments, the best you're going to do is quasi-experimental design using historical controls, is what we would call that in research. So, but again, you can get your feedback. My guess is if you ran this with Odessa, it would be statistically significant. Then, okay. So take a look at this. Take a look at the differences here. In 2014-16, for African American students, they went up 19%. Pretty much, they closed the achievement gap. So from an equity standpoint, I'm going to argue that this work is really good because we're making a connection with students. And here's what folks who work in with non-majority populations will tell you. They will say that students first want the faculty member or the administrator or the staff member to look like them. That's what they will tell you. But they will say the second best is if they get me, whatever that means. Right? If they get me, if they understand me. So making that connection leads to that understanding. So 90% here for African Americans, they have a fairly large Alaskan Native American Indian Pacific Islander. Normally that's a fairly small number. They went up to 95%, and you can see the numbers. You can see the numbers. For whites, they're already high, so they're only went up 3%. Asians, they're only went up 1%. So maybe there isn't something, right? Maybe there is a ceiling effect on all of this. But pretty interesting stuff. Pretty interesting stuff. All because, as you were saying, it's not that hard. Right? This is an engagement. But it's different than how we were taught. Right? Although many of us, when we talk about what happened and what inspired us, it was an instructor that inspired you, was it not? For those of you that talked, it was an instructor or a family member that inspired you to become an educator. A quote from a faculty member at Lake Washington that I really liked. I signed up because we need better retention and I want to re-energize my work as a teacher. I want to re-energize my work as a teacher. What we're finding when we interview faculty, when they talk about this work, is they like their job better. I mean, if you think about this across the curriculum, and you're teaching history, how much does your prep change? Right? History is history. I mean, they're making theories and things, but how much does it change? Right? So getting re-energized is really a good thing to do. And who re-energizes us? Students. It's the student reaction. Okay, what are the commonalities to this? Because we're going to break this down and talk about this afternoon. Clear structure and transparency. In fact, I brought a book. Tell me if any of you have heard of this. The Course Syllabus by Judith Bernard O'Brien. Notice how thick it is. It's a really thick. How long are your syllabus? I'm sorry, what's that?
Two pages.
Don't do that. According to Judith, the syllabus is your contract with your students. How many times have students said to you, you me that. How many times have they said that to you? I didn't know I had to do that. What Judith Gurnon Ryan argues and has examples of is that the syllabus is really your contract. And it is the course in terms of everything a student needs to know to do that course. Making your course transparent. And I realize you're all thinking, well, that's more work. But it's only more work one time. Right? It's only more work one time. Because then you just adjust based on the semester and so forth. She also argues that you want a welcome letter in your syllabus, welcoming your students and what your philosophy is about how you teach. You also want students.
I'm sorry, I wasn't clear. So a 2-page syllabus is not enough?
No.
So you.
18 to 20 pages is what a syllabus is. I know that really sucks, right? Reach out to students if they fall behind. and you have to do it early. Math tends to be cumulative, right? They need this concept in order to go to the next concept. They need that concept in order to go to the next concept. Reach out to students if they fall behind, because if they don't catch up, they're dead. They're dead. Okay. Big one. Consistency with and care about students. This is an attitudinal issue. When I went to college, I could probably name, of all the instructors I took in my bachelor, I went to start in college, and in my community college work, my master's work, my doctoral work, probably on one hand, instructors that I felt really cared about, with all the instructors I had. But those instructors that really cared about me, one of them I said is you and Janice Carroll. That's how close we became. I mean, this guy changed my life in graduate school. I mean, it was really impactful for me. But consistency with and care about students. Okay, what are the big buckets? I'm just going to break it down. Let me go next time. First one, student connection. So we're going to break out after lunch into five groups. And I'm going to walk you through what we're going to do. Student connection, what are students' names on the first day of class, meeting students outside of class. So that's that connection one. Transparent syllabus, detailed and comprehensive with accountable policies. Third big bucket, monitor student progress. Contact students if they fall behind. I don't get it. Assignments and assessments early and often, no later than the second or third class meeting. And then finally, showing care. What does the meaningful contact look like with students? Not just meeting with them, but also meeting with all students. And then finally, that master's of paradox or considerate coach, faculty are willing to consider under extraordinary circumstances, providing students with extra time to complete assignments. These are the five buckets. Okay, let's talk about this. What do you think? Do we want to work on these things? Five things. We're going to break you up into groups. We're just going to sound off. We'll do that before the break. And we're going to start looking at some questions that I have for you. And then what we're going to do is someone will assign a scribe. We have paper here to write up and respond to some questions. Have any of you worked on a World Cafe before? You want a World Cafe? So let me explain what it is. We're gonna number from 1 to 5, we'll put you in 5 different groups, each one corresponding to this. You're gonna work for about 15 to 20 minutes on questions that I have for you. We're gonna write down the responses. And then at that break, everyone but one person is gonna move. So if you're in group 1, you move to group 2. If you're in group 2, you move to group 3. And if you're in group 5, you move to you leave. No, I'm kidding. No, you go back to group 1. Okay. So we're going to do that after lunchtime. And we'll get you started on this. And we'll see if this works out well for you. So, and then one person stays just for a couple minutes to let them know what they talked about. And then you jump over to the next group. Fair enough? So that's what we'll get. It's a lot of fun. We'll really enjoy it. So with that, we're a little bit early.
Yeah,
lunch isn't here yet. Why don't we do this? We have half an hour. Why don't I get your number and get started in groups and introduce yourself? Does everybody know everybody?
Yeah.
Yeah? The address to everyone? Okay. I'm going to number you off. And then what I'd like to do is go into your groups. And maybe what we'll do is we'll address that. We'll start on addressing that first question. Fair enough? So I don't want any waste of time. Yes, please. Yes.
I've seen the data from high school to Citrus.
Okay.
Do you have the data that goes from
Citrus
to 4 years?
I don't anymore. That work is done by the state now. So I ran it for since 1998. But it transitioned over in 2015. So I ran for sorry. But you can ask them for that data. I don't know if you're a Surrounding University participant, but we can talk about it. Okay, numbering, ready? Your math faculty, you're going to get this totally right. You're not going to screw this up, okay? Ready? Oh, I see already. All right.
There you go.
1, 2,
3, 4.
Five,
have these chairs that are brand new. Woo-hoo! Group one here, group two, group three, group four, group five. What inspires you about being a faculty member? So please say your name and what inspires you about being a faculty member? So anything, what